Good morning. Good morning. How's everyone doing? Good. We all have a good Christmas?
Yeah.
Britt had a really good Christmas. All right, why don't y'all stand and we'll pray and we'll get in and worship God. Lord, we just thank you for today, the chance to be in your house, the chance to fellowship with Christ's body. We just ask you to be with us. Everything we say and do would be pleasing to you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take the rain, open hearts.
if the ushers would come forward. Lord, thank you today for your son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the gift that he gave us. Thank you for his life. And we just love him and thank him for everything. And Lord, I just pray you would be with us through the remainder of this service and just bless this offering and put it to your use. Amen.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are. Are for me, and oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us, how he loves us so. Yeah, he loves us so.
Good morning. It's hard to believe that Christmas has already come and gone, and now here it is. We're looking at a new year. You know, it's the last couple of years have been quite challenging, and I know this last year has been challenging for Harmony as well. But you know, it's wonderful that we serve a God that He gives us new days and new years and new times and new opportunities. But also, He's the God of second chances. You know, even though we mess up, even though we've squandered days and times, even though things have not gone the way we want, God has tomorrow in His hands. God's in control, and it's great that we can have the confidence of that. You know, it's great that we can be looking to a God that knows what's coming and what's going to challenge us, but also God knows how to direct us through those days ahead as well. This morning, we're going to be ending this set of questions that we've been looking at over the last month, and we've been looking at questions that deal with Jesus being the Messiah. And this morning, instead of now looking at the evidence or the reasoning for Jesus being the Messiah, now we're going to be looking at an example of how two different apostles took this information to the world, but also how they encountered some problems or some friction that was there, some opposition, and how they handled that as well. They give us a great example of how it is that we should respond to this world and how it is that we have opportunities in this time of darkness. And you'll notice up there on the screen these questions that we have been looking at. And the first week was, is the Christmas story believable? Second week, it was, why are so many wanting to take Christ out of Christmas? Last week, we looked at why we believe that Jesus is Messiah. And just a quick hint or just information on that, there's a little stool out front that has a little track on it, just has some of the information about Jesus being the Messiah and just some of that information that is there. It was going to be here last week, but shipping just didn't work out. But also, I want to just a point of announcement before I forget. This being the new year gives us an opportunity to start looking at God's Word and working through that as well. There's also on the table right out at the doors right there, but also that same little stool, there's a little pamphlet there to help you work through the Bible this year and just read through it each and every day and just kind of keep you on track if that is helpful for you. But anyway, this morning, the question we are looking at is, who should we listen to? And here, that is what happened with Peter and John. They was faced with some people or somebody that was saying, don't preach in the name of Jesus. Don't speak about his gospel. Don't speak about what he did. Don't say this anything at all. You know, our culture and our world today has kind of the same attitude. They don't want us to speak about Jesus. They don't want us to tell about how he has changed our life or about the morality of God. They don't want to tell about things that are convicting or challenging to their lives. But yet God, he gives us a calling. He gives us challenges in our life, and he calls us to something greater than to just cower down, but to be an example, a witness to others. And that's what Peter and John, they show us this example of how it is that we can be this example to others. So with that in mind, would bow your heads with me this morning. Lord, we thank you for just blessing us with giving us another day, Lord, but also the time that you've given us with our families, the time where we was able to celebrate this world and how you gave of yourself so that we could have our sins forgiven, Lord, and we could have a close relationship with you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for your holiness, Lord, how it got us to celebrate. How it shows us where we have fallen short. That by your power we can live through your ways or your holiness, Lord. Lord, we thank you for your grace, how you on each and every one of us, Lord, and help us just be in mind or be mindful about what it is that you have done and how you have given us mercy, even though that we don't deserve your grace and mercy, Lord. Lord, we thank you for being a God that cares as well, a God that gives us gifts, a God that directs us, a God that cares about the direction that we're going in, Lord. And Lord, we thank you for just helping us with the problems that we encounter as well. And Lord, I ask you to be with us this year as we are going into new challenges and new directions. As families, we're going to encounter new obstacles that we haven't encountered. Lord, I ask you to just to be with those of harmony, Lord, and be with the families that they would just be encouraged by your Spirit. But Lord, help us that we would just follow after your direction, that we'd just be mindful of what it is that you're calling us to do, Lord. Lord, I ask you to be with us too as a church, Lord, that we would just be obedient to your calling or challenges that you have for the direction that you have for us as well. And this morning, Lord, as we are looking at your word, Lord, help us to understand this passage, but also how it is that we can apply it in our lives, how it is that we can be a witness and be bold just as Peter and John was. Lord, we thank you for how it is that you work in our lives, Lord. And Lord, I thank you for your Spirit, how it challenges us whenever we're in times like this, Lord. And Lord, I ask you to speak to us on a general level, but Lord, also on a specific level as well this morning. And Lord, I ask you to help me put myself to the side, that I would get across the message you laid upon my heart. And Lord, we thank you for all that you do. In your name we pray. Amen. So here this morning, why should we listen? Who should we listen to? You know, as we've been focusing on these questions, you know, we've been looking at this Christmas season, or we've been looking at the opportunities that the time of Christmas gives us, and now we are going into a new year. New year, new opportunities, and new things that we're going to experience that we've never experienced. There's going to be new challenges. There's going to be hard days. There's going to be great days. You know, but here in this passage, we also see how the Messiah, how it is important. Because, you see, if Jesus is the Messiah, then we should be sharing this message with others. We should be honoring Him with our lives. We should be telling others about what God has done in our lives. We should be listening to God's call. You know, everything in life itself should be secondary, should fall to the side, but as we worship our Lord. And that's what Peter and John, they show us. So similarly, just as we're going into a new time or a new season, and Peter and John, they were in this new time of season as well, because for 3 years they had been following after the Messiah. They had had Him in their life. They had been excited about the Messiah was coming, and they thought that there was going to be this new kingdom that was going to be set up, and Jesus was going to get rid of the Roman Empire. But then now things changed. And they're starting to understand the new plan that God has. They're starting to understand the plan that God had for them specifically all along. And I understand that now they are leaders. They're leaders to other young Christians. They're examples to Christians that were there. Examples to us today. You know, Peter, he was experiencing these new opportunities to talk about the gospel. And as you look at Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 3, here God was just presenting him golden opportunities or times where people were just listening and ready to accept the gospel. Peter, he took advantage of these opportunities. He took advantage of what God laid before him. He took advantage to talk about the gospel and tell them what Christ could do. But also he told them about the prophets. He told them about God had foretold about this. Peter even explained that Jesus was the only way of salvation. So it wasn't just that he was saying, oh, how great God is, but also he was teaching others. You know, it's one thing that's important in our life is that we don't just tell about how great God is, but also we try to disciple others and teach them, help them to learn about God itself, help them to understand the relationship that they can have and grow in that relationship with God as well. But now in the midst of doing God's work, Peter and John, they are faced with some difficulties. Trouble hits them right there in the face. The Jewish leaders that are there, now they are presenting them and they are attacking after them. You could say even Satan himself is attacking him. And they show us this morning how it is that we can respond to the attacks of Satan. But also they present us with a good example of how we can act in difficult situations. And lastly, I can see that they give us a great reminder of how to persevere through challenging times. But the thoughts we're going to be looking at this morning is, the first thought is spending time with God, it changes us. It's just a simple, plain thought. But it's impactful in our life, and it will change us if we truly spend time with our Lord and Master. And the second thought we're going to be looking at is spiritual adversity comes when we are doing God's work. Simple. Whenever we are doing God's work, we should expect Satan to raise up his ugly head. Thirdly, we're looking at being spiritually correct is more important than being politically correct. So these are the examples we see in this. But in our life, we have to understand the importance of how it is that we spend time with God. And this is what Peter and John, they experienced firsthand in their life. So if you would this morning, look with me here at Book of Acts chapter 4 and always, I'm going to read the odd verses, and I'd like you to read with me in the even verses. And I'll begin here in verse 1. In verse 1, it begins, and it says, "And as they were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to them." And they laid hands on them and put them in jail until the next day, for it was already evening. On the next day, their rulers and their elders and the scribes were gathered together in Jerusalem. When they had placed them in the center, they began to inquire, "By what power or in what name have you done this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and governors of the people, If we are on trial today for a benefit done to a sick man as to how this man has been made well, He is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. Now, as they observed the confidence of Peter and John, and understood that they were uneducated and untrained men, they were amazed and began to recognize them as having been with Jesus. But when they had ordered them to leave the council, they began to confer with one another. But so that it will not spread any further among the people, let us warn them to speak no longer in the name in any man, no longer to any man in this name. But Peter and John answered and said to them, "Whether it is right in the sight of God to give heed to you rather than to God, you be the judge." When they had threatened them further, they let them go, finding no basis on which to punish them on account of the people, because they were all glorifying God for what had happened. So here in this passage, it kind of really makes me think of the culture or the climate of our world today, of how it is that people want to challenge us about being Christians, challenge us about what the Word of God says. And in this passage, I see in verses 13 through 16 first that Jewish leaders, they see the disciples and they recognize something about them. They recognize that there's an authority about them. They recognize that they're different than other people that are just out there being religious. And this first principle that we're focusing on this morning is spending time with God changes us. And as I said here in verse 13 through 16, they noticed that this miracle had taken place. And it was something that they could not deny. And in fact, in verse 13, he uses the word confidence. The KJV uses the word boldness. And it gives us an expression or an understanding that they was ready to share their faith. But also, they didn't care about those people that was rejecting them or those people that was trying to quieten them. You know, notice in our text, you know, it's great how it is that God works. But also the fact is that this miracle, it was noteworthy. It was something that they could not deny. So this principle that we see in this is a life that has been touched by God or changed by God. It will speak loudly. And that here they saw this miracle happen in this man's life. And they're saying, we can't deny what has happened. Why don't you stop and reflect upon our own life? Whenever our own life has been changed and we're not doing the same habits or we don't have the same attitude, we're not acting like we used to act, it's going to impact others as well. And other people aren't going to be able to deny who we are or what it is that God has done in us. Just simply, our testimony has a huge bearing on other people's life, has a huge impression upon them. And the scriptures, they point to our testimony and the value of it. Often, whenever Paul was going to these cities and he was going and founding these new churches, he would just tell them what it was that Jesus had done for them. So, you know, it's great to know God's word. It's great to know what it is that we believe and how to explain that to other people. But also, each and every one of us has some simple information. If we are Christians, then we know what God has done in our life. We know how he has changed. We know how God has been there for us. And this is a message that we can explain to others. This is a testimony that we can share with them. And Paul, he shows us here the importance of the changed life. I mean, Peter and John, they show us here the importance of the changed life. And yes, this was a miracle. But whenever God, he saves us and he changes us, that's a miracle as well. In Proverbs chapter 22, it speaks of the value of our character or our testimony itself. And in Proverbs 22:1, it says, "A good name is to be more desired than great wealth. Favor is better than silver and gold." Again, in Proverbs 31:10, it says, "An excellent wife, who can find favor? For her worth is far above jewels." You know, people want to have this reputation. People want to be known as this godly character. They don't want to be known as a Jezebel. They don't want to be known as one that can't be trusted, or one that lies all the time, or one that is stealing all the time, because they know the worth of a testimony. They know the worth of how it is that people see us. Jesus himself said how our actions, they reflect upon who we are. In Luke 6:46-45, it says, "The good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth what is good, and the evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth what is evil. For his mouth speaks from that which fills his heart." It shows us that we're going to end up having the characters, or we're going to be, what is in our heart is going to eventually come out in our life, in our actions. But just quite simply, when we spend time with God, it's going to come out in our life as well. It's going to come out in our character and our attitude. It's going to change us. Here, just as this miracle could not be denied, whenever we spend time with God, it's not going to be able to be denied either. People is going to recognize how it is that we're not responding to them like we used to, or to certain circumstances like we used to. But also, God is going to be receiving the glory for our actions. God is going to be receiving the glory for how it is that he has changed us. And this should be our goal, is getting closer with God so that others can experience this relationship as well. But also, you know, this also speaks to how our actions in life should be changed. You know, I've met people before where they said, you know, I'm a Christian, but, you know, their life or their actions doesn't seem like they've been changed much. You know, I used to work with a guy, and he said, you know, he would come to me and he would say, "Well, Adam, you're just on another spiritual plane. You're just on a higher level with God." And I was thinking, how are you even saying this? I had been saved for about a year, and this guy had been claiming that he had been a Christian for about 10 years. And so there's a problem there if we're not maturing in Christ. There's a problem if we're still a baby in Christ and we're not growing in that relationship. Sometimes we have the knowledge of God, or we have the knowledge of what it is that God can do, but we don't have the power that is present in our life. And there's a problem that is there. There's a problem that we may not be saved at all. And so these are things that we need to consider, and things that we need to be thinking about in our life. But also we need to make sure that we're growing in our character. Abraham Lincoln, he gives this quote, and he says, "Character is like a tree, and reputation like its shadow. The shadow is what we think of it. The tree is the real thing." So people are going to see our character. They're going to see us change. So spending time with God, it changes us, and it helps us to be prepared for the world that is ahead. It helps us be prepared for the challenges that lie ahead as well. You have to think, here it is, Peter and John, for 3 years they had studied with the Master. They had experienced him pray. They had experienced his faith and what it is the Father could do in their lives. And Peter and John, now they were experiencing some tough circumstances themselves, and they was able to these situations. So what I'm saying is, whenever we spend time with God, he can prepare us for what's coming ahead. He can help us for the challenges or the attacks of Satan, what is coming ahead. You know, if we want spiritual success in our life, then it shouldn't be an option of spending time with God. Then we should be making sure that we are spending time with him each and every day. So this upcoming year, we should make it a priority, each and every one of us, that we are spending time with God, that we are trying to get closer with God, that we have this relationship that is growing, that we're being nurtured in that relationship, and therefore we're being a brighter witness to others as well. So spending time with God, it changes us. But secondly, we're looking at this passage, and I can see in verses 17 to 18, The spiritual adversity that comes when we are doing God's work. The second principle, you know, it's clear to anybody that has been a Christian very long. Because anybody that's been a Christian very long, whenever you're trying to sincerely do God's word and follow God's will in your life, you've had the encounter of Satan in your life. You've had the attacks of Satan trying to knock you down, trying not to let you do God's work. Notice in our text in verse 17 and 18, it says, "But so that it will not spread any further among the people, let us warn them to speak no longer to any man in this name." And when they had summoned them, they commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. First of all, we should all recognize who our enemy is. Our enemy is not each other. Our enemy is not mankind. Our enemy is spiritual forces. It's Satan himself. It's the darkness of this world. It is evil itself. It is Satan that is trying to attack us. So we should recognize that Satan is the one that is trying to silence us, trying to not get us to be this testimony to other people or this beacon of light to other people. But also we should not let the attacks of Satan stop us from doing God's work. It shouldn't be a surprise that we're encountering trouble, so that shouldn't discourage us. We shouldn't be getting down and saying, "Well, I'm experiencing this, and now I should just quit." You know, this is a great day because we get to look forward to the future, but also it's a sad, challenging day as well. Matthew's going to be leaving us today, and Matthew's going to be going into this new work, and he's going to be experiencing challenges. But whenever Satan attacks you, you keep persevering. You keep going. And that goes for each and every one of us. Whenever Satan attacks us, we should be saying, "Oh, woe is me. What is going on, God?" But we should recognize that God has a direction and that God can help us through those spiritual dark times. Pay attention to God's direction. But also be aware and understand that Satan is going to do this and how he is our enemy. In fact, we should be watching out and looking for Satan to be raising up his head and how he's going to attack us. In this passage, though, they don't want him to preach in the name of Jesus. They don't want him to teach. Satan, he recognizes the power of the name of Christ. He recognizes what it is that Christ can do in the hearts of people. And there's no other name that offends like the name of Jesus. I remember a few years ago, there was a high school football coach. I think he was actually in the state of Washington, and he was praying before each game, and he was praying in the name of Jesus. And he had made national news, and people were so upset about this, and they were attacking him. There was persecution that was going on. But you know what? If he had been a Buddhist or these other religions, the attack wouldn't have been there. Because the name of Jesus, it offends. And you know, it's important that we make sure that we stand for our God, because our God is the one that has given us grace and mercy. He's given us salvation. But also, we should not be surprised, though, whenever Satan, he's trying to attack us. That should catch us off guard. But also, these threats and these persecutions that are coming at us, you know, they shouldn't surprise us or discourage us or cause us to stop doing God's work. Notice in our text, you know, they were not stopped at all by the intimidation. In fact, in verse 10, it says, here it is, they was looking and they was upset with him and they was questioning, "What it is, why are you doing this?" And Peter responds back in verse 10. He says, "Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus of the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health." He says, "You killed him. You did this." These aren't nice, kind words, what it is that Peter is saying. These aren't sweet, lovely things. But he's saying, "Look what you have done. You have killed the Messiah. You did this. God, he had his hand out for us, and you slapped God's hand." But then he's preaching to them the gospel and showing them that now there's no other way of salvation. He's standing firm on the message, but also he's showing them the grace of God. He shows us in verse 19 as well. It says, "But Peter and John answered and said to them, 'Whether it is right in the sight of God to give heed to you rather than to God, you be the judge. For we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard.'" Quite clearly, we should not let Satan stop us. We should keep pressing on. We should keep doing God's work. Christ, he foreknew of these attacks. He foreknew and he forewarned as well what would happen to the disciples. He knew what was going to happen in his own ministry, in his own life, but also he reminded us as well. In verse 22 of Luke chapter 9, it says, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and raised up on the third day. And he was saying to them all, if any man wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. See, we should consider for our own life, if we don't do God's will, or if we quit, or if we let Satan discourage us, who is going to do God's will? Who is going to do God's work? You know, in Isaiah chapter 6, he got this glimpse of God and he said, woe is me. But then also he heard the call of God going out. And here we should hear when God speaks to us and he challenges us, he calls us to do something. We should say, Lord, I'm here. I'm ready to do your work. We should be listening and obedient to what God lays before each and every one of us. So just a reminder, the two thoughts we looked at is spending time with God, it changes us. Secondly, the spiritual adversity, it comes when we are doing God's work. The third thing we're looking at is being spiritually correct is more important than being politically correct. And as I was looking at this passage, here it is. They're being told to deny Jesus, here you can say, well, they're not told actually to deny Jesus. But see, whenever we're told not to speak or teach or do what it is that God has told us to do, we're being told to deny him. Silence is denying our God, and we need to realize that as well. But in this passage, in these verses itself, in verse 19, the question that we are looking at this morning of who should we listen to, we have to realize that this was not a question at all for Peter and John. Whenever they encountered those that were saying, this is what you should do, they're responding back, we're not going to listen to you, we're going to listen to our almighty God and creator that created this universe, that created my life and my soul that I am answerable to. You may have physical power over what you can do to me, but you don't have power over my soul. And that's why here, Peter and John, they recognize and they show us. They understood who they were standing before. These men, these Jewish leaders, they were just bystanders in the room because God was the one that they were standing before. It says in verse 19, it says, but Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to give heed to you rather than to God, you be the judge. They're saying, my actions, what I'm doing right now, I'm accountable to my God, to my Creator, to my Savior that died for my sins. I'm accountable for what it is that I have done. So this opposition that was trying to stop them from doing what was right inside of God, this opposition was not who they were accountable to. So this should be a great reminder to us that we need to be following God's direction, not the direction of this world. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. In fact, verse 6 is probably the passage that has spoken the strongest to me as my life as a Christian. But in 3 and 5, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. Verse 6, it goes in and says, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall make your path straight. If we acknowledge God in everything that we do, and God's going to be there for us, and God's going to give us direction for every problem that we encounter, for every day that is before us. When we're following the direction of God, we're going to have a different perspective on life as well. Whenever we're encountering these problems, we're going to realize that God has still given me a calling, that God has still challenged me, that God has still spoken to my heart, and regardless of the challenges or the problems that are at hand, I still have a calling from my God to do what he has told me to do. So put the world to the side. Peter and John, they understood that Jesus told them to go and preach into all the world. In fact, in Acts 1 and 8, you'll see up here on the screen, it says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be my witness both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria, even into the the remotest part of the earth. Matthew 28, 19 through 20, it says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the ages." So he says, here's your calling, but remember, I'm there with you. Remember, I'm there for you. And we need to realize this, regardless about the opposition that we encounter in our life or the persecution, our callings do not change. What God has laid before us is still before us, and the work that God has for us to do still needs to be completed. So God expects us to go and be this witness, this light to this world, this dark world itself. But as Christians, we are to realize that God is the one that we are to please. It's not other people. I'm not here to please you. I'm here to please my God and my Savior. He's the one that I'm answerable and accountable to. Nothing should compare to our God. Nothing should be coming between us and God. And just as John and Peter didn't have a question about who they were going to listen to, we should not either. We should be listening to the direction of God. We should be resolved in our life to do God's will, and regardless of the face of opposition. We should be following after what God wants us to do, regardless what the culture is telling us to do. We should be faithful to God's word, regardless of the hard times or persecution that lies ahead of us. You know, it's about what God has called us to do, not what makes other people happy. You know, one of the first churches I began pastoring, I encountered somebody that came to me one day, and they came and they said, you know, as a pastor, when you're preaching, you're not entertaining the people. My job is not to entertain people. My job is to preach God's word. Our job in each and every one of us is not to make people feel good or try to entertain them in some way, but it's to be truthful with what the word of God is. It's to hand people the life, the words of life. It's to show them what it is that God can do in their life. My calling is between me and my God. It's not what other people want us to do. Peter, he said in verse 19, let me read this again. Actually, verse 20, it says, "For we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard." See, we have this example, or we have this opportunity to be in other people's life as well, to speak the truth. Verse 20, it shows us the importance of speaking this truth and showing them what has happened in our life, but also the truth of who God is. They were focused on preaching what they had experienced, what had happened in their life. This resurrection story, it wasn't just an event that they had heard about, but it was an event that they saw in their life and had changed them. It was an event that they was ready to go to their deaths about. It was an event that had changed them from these little fishers men, these little men that was out fishing for their wages and for their job, but now they was fishers of men, and they was willing to tell others what Christ could do in their life as well. They was telling them the truth that was there. So this gives us an example that we should be giving this truth to others as well. It changed their life. It should change our life as well. Our life should be changed and different from Christ being in our life, from following after God. So looking at this story, whenever we see how they encountered trouble or trials that was right there before them, this should motivate us. This should motivate us that regardless about the trials that we encounter, that our God is there with us, but also our God is there to help us through these problems as well. This morning, as our musicians come, it gives us an opportunity to respond to this message or to this passage itself, to the Holy Spirit, whatever He has spoken to us about this morning. We should be resolved like Peter and John. We should be excited to do God's work. So regardless of the opposition, and just as Peter and John, we should be focused on doing God's will. If you would, bow your heads with me. Lord, we thank you for your grace this morning. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for being a God that reaches down and touches our hearts and speaks to us and challenges us. Lord, I ask you, if you have spoken to anyone this morning, if you have challenged them in any way, Lord, that you'd give them the boldness, as Peter and John had, to come forward this morning, to come to the altar and pray, Lord, to respond to whatever challenge that you're laying before them. Lord, we thank you for how it is that you do work and you give us second chances. Lord, we thank you for your mercy this morning. Thank you for all that you do. In your name we pray. Amen.